Knitting his brow, powerless to utter a single word, Atreus stood gazing at the childlike Empress. He had no idea how to begin or what to do. He had often tried to imagine this moment, he had prepared words and phrases, but they had all gone out of his head. At length, she smiled at him. Her voice when she spoke was as soft as the voice of a bird singing in its sleep.
"You have returned from the great quest, Atreus."
Atreus hung his head. "Yes," he managed to say. After a short silence, she went on.
"Your lovely cloak has turned grey, your hair is grey, and your skin is like stone. But all that will be as it was, or better, you'll see."
Atreus felt as if a band had tightened around his throat. All he could do was nod his head. Then he heard the sweet, soft voice saying,
"You have carried out your mission?"
Were these words meant as a question? Atreus didn't know. He didn't dare look up to read the answer in her face. Slowly, he reached for the golden amulet and removed the chain from his neck. Without raising his eyes, he held it out to the childlike Empress. He tried to kneel as messengers did in the stories and songs he had heard at home, but his wounded leg refused to do his bidding. He fell at the childlike Empress's feet, and there he lay with his face to the floor. She bent forward, picked up Orin, and let the chain glide through her fingers.
"You have done well, and I am pleased with you."
"No," cried Atreus almost savagely. "It was all in vain. There is no hope." A long silence followed. Atreus buried his face in the crook of his elbow, and his whole body trembled. How would she react? With a cry of despair? A moan? Words of bitter reproach or even anger? Atreus couldn't have said what he expected. Certainly not what he heard. A soft, contented laugh. Atreus' thoughts were in a whirl. For a moment he thought she had gone mad. But that was not the laughter of madness. Then he heard her say,
"But you have brought him with you."
Atreus looked up. "Who?"
"Our savior."
He looked into her eyes and found only serenity. She smiled again. "Golden-eyed commander of wishes," he stammered, now for the first time using the official words of address that Falkor had recommended. I don't understand."
"I can see that by the look on your face, but whether you understand or not, you've done it, and that's what counts, isn't it?"
Atreus said nothing. He couldn't even think of a question to ask. He stood there, open-mouthed, staring at the childlike Empress.
"I saw him,"
she went on.
"And he saw me."
"When?" Atreus asked.
"Just as you came in. You brought him with you."
Involuntarily, Atreus looked around. "Then where is he? I don't see anyone but you and me."
"Oh, the world is full of things you don't see. You can believe me. He isn't in our world yet. But our worlds have come close enough together for us to see each other. For a twinkling, the thin wall between us became transparent. He will be with us soon, and then he will call me by the new name that he alone can give me. Then I shall be well, and so will Fantastica."
As the childlike Empress was speaking, Atreus raised himself with difficulty. He looked up to her as she lay on her bed of cushions. His voice was husky when he asked, "Then you've known my message all along? What Morla the Aged One told me in the Swamps of Sadness? What the mysterious voice of Uyulala and the Southern Oracle revealed to me? You knew it all?"
"Yes, I knew it before I sent you on the great quest."
Atreus gulped. "Why?" he finally managed to ask. "Why did you send me then? What did you expect me to do?"
"Exactly what you did."
"What I did?" Atreus repeated slowly, his forehead clouded over. "In that case," he said angrily, "it was all unnecessary. There was no need of sending me on the great quest. I've heard that your decisions are often mysterious. That may be, but after all I've been through, I hate to think that you were just having a joke at my expense." The childlike Empress's eyes grew grave.
"I was not having a joke at your expense, Atreus. I am well aware of what I owe you. All your sufferings were necessary. I sent you on the great quest, not for the sake of the message you would bring me, but because that was the only way of calling our savior. He took part in everything you did, and he has come all that long way with you. You heard his cry of fear when you were talking with Yggdrasil beside the deep chasm, and you saw him when you stood facing the magic mirror gate. You entered into his image and took it with you, and he followed you, because he saw himself through your eyes. And now, too, he can hear every word we are saying. He knows we are talking about him. He knows we have set our hope in him and are expecting him. Perhaps He even understands that all the hardship you, Atreyu, took upon yourself was for his sake, and that all of Fantastica is calling him.
Little by little, the darkness cleared from Atreyu's face. After a while, he asked, "How can you know all that? The cry by the deep chasm and the image in the magic mirror, did you arrange it all in advance?" The childlike empress picked up Orin and said while putting the chain around her neck,
"Didn't you wear the gem the whole time? Didn't you know that through it, I was always with you?"
"Not always," said Atreyu. "I lost it."
"Yes, then you were really alone. Tell me, what happened to you then?"
Atreyu told her the story.
"Now I know why you turned gray. You were too close to the nothing."
"Gmork, the werewolf, told me," said Atreyu, "that when a Fantastican is swallowed up by the nothing, he becomes a lie. Is that true?"
"Yes, it is true,"
said the childlike empress, and her golden eyes darkened.
"All lies were once creatures of Fantastica. They are made up of the same stuff, but they have lost their true nature and become unrecognizable. But as you might expect from a half and half creature like Gmork, he only told you half the truth. There are two ways of crossing the dividing line between Fantastica and the human world, a right one and a wrong one. When Fantasticans are cruelly dragged across it, that's the wrong way. When humans, children of man, come to our world of their own free will, that's the right way. Every human who has been here has learned something that could be learned only here, and returned to his own world, a changed person. Because he had seen you creatures in your true form, he was able to see his own world and his fellow humans with new eyes, where he had seen only dull, everyday reality. He now discovered wonders and mysteries. That is why humans were glad to come to Fantastica, and the more these visits enriched our world, the fewer lies there were in theirs, the better it became. Just as our two worlds can injure each other, they can also make each other whole again."
For a time, both were silent. Then she went on.
"Humans are our hope. One of them must come and give me a new name, and he will come."
Atreyu made no answer.
"Do you understand now, Atreyu? Why I had to ask so much of you? Only a long story full of adventures, marvels and dangers could bring our savior to me, and that was your story."
Atreyu sat deep in thought. At length he nodded. "Yes, golden-eyed commander of wishes, now I understand. I thank you for choosing me. Forgive my anger."
"You had no way of knowing these things, and that too was necessary."
Again Atreyu nodded. After a short silence he said, "But I'm very tired."
"You have done enough, Atreyu. Would you like to rest?"
"Not yet. First, I would like to see the happy outcome of my story. If, as you say, I've carried out my mission, why isn't the Savior here yet? What's he waiting for?"
"Yes, what is he waiting for?"
Bastion felt his hands growing moist with excitement. "I can't do it," he said. "I don't even know what I'm supposed to do. Maybe the name I've thought of isn't the right one." "May I ask you another question?" said Atreyu.
"Of course,"
she answered with a smile. "Why do you need a new name to get well?"
"Only the right name gives beings and things their reality. A wrong name makes everything unreal. That's what lies do."
"Maybe the Savior doesn't yet know the right name to give you."
"Oh yes, he does,"
she assured him. Again they sat silent. "I know it all right," said Bastion. "I knew it the moment I laid eyes on her, but I don't know what I have to do." Atreyu looked up. "Maybe he wants to come and just doesn't know how to go about it."
"All he has to do is to call me by my new name, which he alone knows, nothing more."
Bastion's heart pounded. Should he try? What if he didn't succeed? What if he was wrong? What if they weren't talking about him, but about some entirely different savior? How could he be sure they really meant him? "Could it be," said Atreyu after a while, "that he doesn't know it's him and not somebody else we're talking about?"
"No, not after all the signs he has had. He can't be that stupid."
"I'll give it a try," said Bastion, but he couldn't get a word out of his mouth. What if it actually worked? Then he would somehow be transported to Fantastica? But how? Maybe he would have to go through some sort of change, and what would that be like? Would it hurt? Would he lose consciousness? And did he really want to go to Fantastica? He wanted to go to Atreyu and the childlike Empress, but he wasn't at all keen on all those monsters the place was swarming with. Maybe he hasn't got the courage, Atreyu suggested.
Courage? Does it take courage to say my name?
Then, said Atreyu, I can think of only one thing that may be holding him back.
And what would that be?
After some hesitation, Atreyu blurted out, He just doesn't want to come here. He just doesn't care about you or Fantastica. We don't mean a thing to him. The childlike Empress stared wide-eyed at Atreyu. No, no, Bastion cried out. You mustn't think that. It's not that at all. Oh, please, please don't think that. Can you hear me? It's not like that, Atreyu.
He promised me he would come. I saw it in his eyes.
Yes, that's true. And I will come soon. I just need time to think. It's not so simple. Atreyu hung his head, and the two of them waited a long while in silence. But the Savior did not appear, and there wasn't the slightest sign to suggest that he was trying to attract their attention. Bastion was thinking of how it would be if he suddenly stood before them in all his fatness, with his bow legs and his pasty face. He could literally see the disappointment in the childlike Empress's face when she said to him, What brings you here? And Atreyu might even laugh. The thought brought a blush to Bastion's cheeks. Obviously, they were expecting a prince, or at any rate, some sort of hero. He just couldn't appear before them. It was out of the question. He would do anything for them, anything but that. When at last the childlike Empress looked up, the expression of her face had changed. Atreyu was almost frightened at its grandeur and severity. He knew where he had once seen that expression. In the Sphinx's.
There is one more thing I can do. But I don't like it, and I wish he wouldn't make me.
What is that? Atreyu asked in a whisper.
Whether he knows it or not, he is already part of the never-ending story. He can no longer back out of it. He made me a promise, and he has to keep it. But by myself, I can't make him.
Who in all Fantastica, Atreyu asked, can do what you cannot?
Only one person, if he wants to. The old man of Wandering Mountain.
Atreyu looked at the childlike Empress in amazement. The old man of Wandering Mountain, he repeated, stressing every word. You mean he exists?
Did you doubt it?
The old folk in our tent camps tell the children about him when they're naughty. They say he writes everything down in a book, whatever you do or fail to do, and there it stays in the form of a beautiful or an ugly story. When I was little, I believed it, but then I decided it was only an old wives' tale to frighten children.
You never can tell about old wives' tales,
she said with a smile. Then you know him, Atreyu asked. You've seen him? She shook her head.
If I find him, it will be our first meeting.
Our old folk also say, Atreyu went on, that you never can know where the old man's mountain will be at any particular time. They say that when he appears, it's always unexpectedly, now here, now there, and that you can only run across him by accident or because the meeting was fated.
That's true. You can't look for the old man of Wandering Mountain. You can only find him.
Does that go for you too?
Yes, for me too.
But what if you don't find him?
If he exists, I'll find him,
she said with a mysterious smile. Her answer puzzled Atreyu. Hesitantly he asked, Is he like you?
He is like me, because he is my opposite in every way.
Atreyu saw that with such questions he would get nothing out of her, and another thought weighed on him. You are deathly sick, golden-eyed commander of wishes, he said almost sternly. You won't go far by yourself. All your servants and courtiers seem to have abandoned you. Falkor and I would be glad to take you wherever you wish, but frankly, I don't know if Falkor has the strength. And my foot, well, you've seen that it won't carry me.
Thank you, Atreyu. Thank you for your brave and loyal offer, but I am not planning to take you with me. To find the old man of Wandering Mountain, one must go alone. And even now, Falkor is not where you left him. He has been moved to a place where his wounds will be healed and his strength renewed. And you too, Atreyu, will soon be in that same place.
Her fingers played with Orin. What place is that?
There is no need for you to know now. You will be moved in your sleep. And one day, you will know where you were.
But how can I sleep? Cried Atreyu, so shaken that he lost his sense of tact. How can I sleep when I know you may die any minute? The childlike Empress laughed softly.
I'm not quite as forsaken as you think. I've already told you that there are some things you can't hope to understand. I have my 7 powers, which belong to me, as your memory or courage or thoughts belong to you. They cannot be seen or heard, and yet they are with me at this moment. I shall leave 3 of them with you and Falkor to look after you. and I shall take the other four with me as my escort. You needn't worry, Atreyu. You can sleep easy.
At these words, all the accumulated weariness of the great quest descended on Atreyu like a dark veil. Yet it was not the leaden weariness of exhaustion, but a gentle longing for sleep. He still had many questions to ask the golden-eyed commander of wishes, but he felt that her last words had vanquished all his wishes but one, the wish for sleep. His eyes closed, and still in a sitting position, he glided into the darkness. The clock in the steeple struck 11. As though far in the distance, Atreyu heard the childlike empress give an order in a soft voice. Then he felt powerful arms lifting him gently and carrying him away. For a long time, all was dark and warm around him. Much later, he half awoke when a soothing liquid touched his parched lips and ran down his throat. He had a vague impression that he was in a great cave with walls of gold. He saw the white luck dragon lying beside him. And then he saw, or thought he saw, a gushing fountain in the middle of the cave, encircled by two snakes, a light one and a dark one, which were biting each other's tail. But then an invisible hand brushed over his eyes. The feel of it was infinitely soothing, and again he fell into a deep and dreamless sleep. At that moment, the childlike empress left the ivory tower. She lay bedded on soft silken cushions in a glass litter, which seemed to be moving under its own power, but was actually being carried by four of the empress's invisible servants. They crossed the labyrinth garden, or rather what was left of it, making frequent detours, since many of the paths ended in the nothing. When at length they left the labyrinth, the invisible carriers stopped. They seemed to be waiting for a command. The childlike empress sat up on her cushions and cast a glance back at the ivory tower. Then, sinking back, she said,
"Keep going. Just keep going. No matter where."
Blown by the wind, her snow-white hair trailed behind the glass litter like a flag.